Stay.
How is everybody doing today? Good, good. Well, my mic is on this time. I remember to turn it on, so that's a good start. Well, I am really excited that you are here this morning. If you don't know me, my name is Heather, and my husband, AJ, and I, we have the privilege of leading the student and the young adult ministry here at Revolution Church, and I am really excited that you are joining us this morning, in particular, because if you didn't know this, we had a girls' event last night, and it was incredible. Were any of you there last night? Stuff. It was an awesome night, and the Lord moved in an incredible way, and I am so excited that you are here so that I can thank you personally, because I know a lot of you have given a lot of yourself for this event. You have donated your time, or you have given something to this. You have joined us in prayer, and if you've been praying for this event, I just want to personally say thank you, because the enemy, he was at war against me a lot last night before I walked on stage. And I remember Shelly pulled me aside and said that she had been praying for this event, and it calmed something in my spirit. And so I am so thankful for you guys and for this church, and I'm especially thankful for our planning team. If you guys are in here, would you guys give a round of applause for the planning team? We have sat around tables and we have planned and prayed and have been expectant for the Lord to do something. And so if you're a part of that, I'm so thankful for you guys. But our Awaken Weekend is not over, and I have the privilege of bringing the word this morning. And my most biggest thank you of all is to Richard and Holly. I don't know where you are because it's hard to see people. There's Holly. But I'm so thankful for you guys. I wasn't going to say this. I told myself not to say this, but somehow it's still coming out of my mouth. But this is not where I want it to be this morning. I have to be honest. Holly tells me a lot of things that I'm doing, and I say no for a really long time because I don't think that she knows what she's talking about all the time. But somehow the Lord still brought me up here, and I'm very humbled by it, and I recognize the privilege and the how this platform is sacred to bring the word to you guys, and I don't take it lightly. I have been burdened with a message for you guys, and it's a heavy, heavy message in a way on my heart this morning, but I'm excited to get in, and I'm so thankful for you, Richard and Holly, and the way that you have loved AJ and I really well. So we love you, but I'm going to open us in prayer before we get started. Father God, I pray you would be in this place. Lord, I pray that you would flood this room. Jesus, I pray every single word that you're asking me to say, Lord, I pray that I would have the boldness to say it in your name, Jesus. Lord God, I pray against discouragement, against lies in this room, Lord. I rebuke the enemy in the name of Jesus because I know he's at war right now. And I know what I'm about to say is going to offend some people. And I'm okay with that for a little bit. But Lord, I pray that the word, Lord God, the truth that is in that, Lord, I pray that it would plant a seed, God. I pray that it would plant a seed so deep, Lord God, that the enemy can't do anything to get that seed out. Lord, would you have your way in this room? Would we be obedient to anything and everything you're asking us? In your precious name, amen. Cool, cool. Well, I want to ask you guys to do something really quick, and I purposefully plan this to do you after we pray, because sometimes people are used to like, okay, stick your hands out, we're going to pray now. But I want you guys to be wide-eyed and do this. Would you guys open your hands and stick your hands out in front of you? Not to be weird, but as a gesture that you're open to whatever the Lord has for you. And would you repeat what I say so that we can ready our hearts as a church together? Would you say, God, whatever it is, however it's said, you have a word for me today. Help me to be obedient with whatever you're asking, no matter what it costs. Awesome. Would you guys turn in your Bibles with me to John 6? We are going to be studying a little bit about the feeding of the 5,000, but in sort of a different way. And I'm going to be reading John 6. And then, you guys, if you don't have your Bible, I think it'll be up on the screen. Hopefully I got my notes in time. But after this, Jesus crossed over the far side of the Sea of Galilee, also known as the Sea of, I don't know how to say that. I'm just pretend. Tiger. Let's call it Tiger. Cool. A huge crowd kept following him wherever he went because they saw his miracle signs as he healed the sick. Then Jesus climbed up on a hill and sat with his disciples around him. And it was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration. And Jesus saw Jesus soon saw a huge crowd of people coming to look at him. Turning to Philip, he said, "Where can we buy bread to feed all these people?" And he was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. And Philip replied, "Even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them." Then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up and said, "There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good is that with this huge crowd?" "Tell everyone to sit down," Jesus said. And they all sat down on the grassy slopes, and the men alone numbered over 5,000. And then Jesus took the loaves, and he gave thanks, and he distributed them to the people. And afterward, he did the same thing with the fish. And they all ate as much as they wanted. And after everyone was full, Jesus told his disciples, "Now gather the leftovers so that nothing is wasted." So they picked up the pieces of the pieces that were left over and filled the baskets with scraps that had eaten over the people who had eaten over the 5 barley loaves. I wish that I had a felt board like my Sunday school teacher, so I could feel like a boss today. I don't even know if you guys know what a felt board is. Does anybody know what a felt board is? Yeah, with those little things, how did they stay up? I don't know. It's really cool, but I don't have a felt board. Wish I did. Could arrange that. But I'm sure that you have heard this miracle a million times before, and you know about it. You could say it inside and out. But we have Jesus with his disciples, and they're on the mountainside. And Jesus is healing, and he's ministering to the crowd. And because his miracles are spreading like crazy, wherever he goes, he basically draws a crowd. People just want to see what he's going to do next. They want to be a part of it. And Jesus was teaching them, and after a while, one of his disciples says, "Yo, Jesus, your Apple Watch is broken. You drop it on the floor again. I'm not sure if you realize this, but it's getting late." And Jesus is like, "Okay, so where should we buy bread from them?" And he's like, "Dude, 8 months' wages. If we worked for all these months and worked for all this money to buy this food, we wouldn't have enough for these people to have just one single bite. You know, we call this the feeding of the 5,000, but that was just counting the men. And so if we were to count the women and the children that were most likely there at the time, this would be 20,000 plus people." So he sends his disciples out into the crowd, and we see this from other accounts of the gospel. And the disciple comes back with this boy who has 5 loaves and 2 fish. And Jesus is like, "Oh, perfect, just what I wanted. Tell everybody to sit down. We're going to break the bread. We're going to give thanks. We're going to feed everybody." And it's this crazy miracle that has continual overflow. But there are 2 things about this passage that really bother me. The first has bothered me since I was a kid. I was always, with my little felt board, shown a picture of the bread and the fish like this. Do we have it? Okay, like this. Have you seen this before? And it has bothered me to my core. Did these people just eat raw fish? Like, I do not understand. Did Jesus, like, cook the fish, then give the fish? I don't understand how they ate the fish. It irritates me. You're laughing, but I'm currently irritated in my arms by this very thought. But the second thing that bothers me about this passage is that there was only one boy. Jesus sent his disciples out to find food from what the crowd had. And now, I don't know this. I don't know if Jesus said, "Just find one kid and come back with that one kid." I don't think that's what's happened. I don't understand how there's only one boy that had food. Because here's what bothers me. If you know me well, you know me that I love snacks. And if I go anywhere, I bring snacks. And if I don't have snacks, I always make friends with people that do have snacks. And so Mama Pat, she brings me juice boxes. I eat the goldfish from the nursery and whatever leftover candy from the Easter carnival. Everywhere I go, I find snacks. And so I know that a crowd of 20,000 people, do any of you have snacks in your bags right now? Oh my gosh, see, there are people bring snacks, yeah. I know that in a crowd of 20,000 people, there's not, this one boy is not the only kid that has snacks. There's no way. There's no way that that could have happened. And like I was saying, I don't know if Jesus just said, "Hey, just find one kid and come back." I don't think that's what happened. But it has really got me thinking. It's really got me worried and burdened. Revolution, are we raising a generation behind us where when Jesus asks for them, they stay seated in a crowd? Or revolution, whoever you are we raising a generation behind us where when Jesus asks for something, we give it all no matter what it costs? Now, I know some of you rolled your eyes and you tuned out. Maybe you're tuned deaf, I don't know. But you toned out, tuned out because you don't have kids. You don't care about children. You're not even married. You hate kids, you hate marriage, you hate everything. And this doesn't apply to you because you have nobody that is connected to you. And so you think this message, this passage doesn't apply to you. And church, I didn't say, parents, how are you raising your kids? I said revolution. What kind of generation are you raising behind you? What kind of legacy are you leaving? This was one child who gave it all and withheld nothing. And yes, childlike faith is what we're called to have, but I believe that there was more happening right here. I believe it was his faith mixed with a faithful example before him, because he watched this somewhere. Somebody taught this little boy to go forward. Somebody taught this little boy to give it all to Jesus. Just like somebody taught the crowd to stay seated. Church, are you a faithful example? Whether you like it or not, the generation behind you is watching your every move. Here at church, at your home, with your kids, what you post on Facebook, what you like, what you retweet, what you share, they are watching you. And every move you make, they are learning what it is to be a man or a woman of God. The path you're on right now, if they were to take it, would it lead them to Jesus and being part of a miracle, or would it lead them being seated in a crowd? See, I'm not okay with one boy stepping forward. I'm not okay with it. I'm praying for a generation to rise up where they are unashamed of the gospel, where they are unashamed of his truth, and when they hear his voice, that they leave everything that they're doing and they run straight towards him. In church, I've been praying. Our students know this, but I've been praying that it starts here. If we want to be a church where our legacy is movement, I think there are some things that we need to be reminded of today. So men, if it's okay with you, I'm going to start with you. And all the men in the church just went, yikes. Because you're used to this, right? Somebody is always complaining about a man, no matter where you go. And listen, brothers, I understand you. Because by accident, a couple weeks ago, I was, by accident, one of the dudes. We lead a life group, a young adult life group, AJ and I, at our house on Tuesday nights. And I think Ethan's laughing because he knows what I'm going to say. It was overtime. I was sitting there at my kitchen table, and I looked up, and it was like me and six other dudes. And I was like, oh. And then I asked Sherrod, I said, what do you guys talk about when they're together? And he said, oh, stupid stuff. And so, naturally so, being the person that I am, I made every single one of those guys go around and tell me their stupidest dude moments and stories that they have ever had. And by golly, I am more worried about this gender than ever before. Golly, you guys need to walk around wearing a helmet or something. But I understand you now. I'm one of the dudes. So my intentions today are not to make you feel bad or point out every way that you're failing. My heart today is to be used by God as a vessel to remind you gently of the calling that God placed upon your life. Because you men, whether you like it or not, whether you're married or not, this generation's looking at you. So would you turn with me to Genesis 2? We're going to be reading in verse 15. We are going to be looking at the creation of man and woman, and we're going to see what God from the very beginning of time asked of them to be. And more specifically, what he said to them after they were formed. See, because we cannot lead a generation of movers until we know where we're moving from. So let's read with me. It says, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden. But you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat it, you will surely die. Something I love about God's word is that it's living and it's active. It's alive. And if you are bored when you come to this book, you ain't doing it right. Because every time you come to this book, there's something new to be learned. And if you know me well, I know some of our student girls, they just cringed really hard because I like only talk about Genesis 1, 2, and 3. I am obsessed with this passage. And yes, if I can, I will put it in every single message that I write. I just will. But studying for this message, the Lord showed me something that I hadn't really seen before. It's always been there, but for whatever reason, I overlooked its importance. Men, in this passage, you have two assignments from God that He laid out from the very beginning of time. But something I have missed a million times is that the call to make the first step of faith was given to you. You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat of it, you will surely die. See, Adam knew who God was. He knew that he was formed out of the dust and breathed into by God. He knew God. He knew Him intimately. He walked with God. He talked with God. His relationship with the Lord was not tainted at this time. He knew God face to face. But in front of Adam, always from the very beginning of time, was the opportunity to trust God at His word or to disobey Him. And God entrusted that opportunity to Adam first. Man, I don't know what your life looks like. I don't know what your family is going through or what mountains are standing in front of you. But you were given the call to make the first step of faith. And before we get into the two things that God laid out for you, I want to pause here for a second. Because I know that there are steps of faith that maybe you're not taking right now. And you think like, man, it's all right. Because my step of faith, I know that it's hindering my relationship with the Lord. And you're okay with it affecting you a little bit. Because you're okay with taking that brunt of that that disconnecting from God. But I know if I were to tell you how your step of faith affects the people around you, how it affects the women and the children, the students in this church, the men behind you, you wouldn't just move, you would run. If you turned around and you saw every single eye that was watching you, every woman, every student, every child that is counting on you to see where your feet land and nowhere to move, you would run. When a man is walking a life of faith, he's walking in obedience to God. And when a man makes a step of faith, despite how the world would view his decision, because his desire is to pursue God, generations are moved. They can't stand still. They are moved by your steps of faith. And I believe every time you make a step of faith, you sow a seed into the heart of the eyes that are watching you. I didn't always understand this as a kid, but I do now. I watched my parents growing up make crazy steps of faith. When we had nothing, and I mean nothing, I watched my parents step out in faith. I watched them be faithful to give and to tithe, and not just the 10%. I watched my family tithe in faith beyond because they believed who God was. And my family is just as jacked up as the next, but my parents as a child taught me what it was like to live a life of faith. And they never sat me down and said, Heather, do this, and this is going to be the perfect formula for you to have a perfect relationship with God. I watched this messy, raw thing take place. They lived it, and I just watched, which is more contagious in my opinion. And did you know what comes to my mind when AJ and I are in a hard place and we're asked to make a scary step of faith by God? I think of my parents. And I think about their steps of faith and how God was always faithful, even when it didn't make sense. I watched my parents tell me that God was faithful. And I watched them be scared and step out in faith anyways. And they sowed something into me that cannot be undone in faith. Church, if we want the generation behind us to live a life of faith, we need to start stepping out in faith. This is 100% opposite of what our culture is teaching them. But we are not made to be people who follow the ways of culture, but we were made and we were called to be grounded in His truth. We were called to live a life of faith. So let's keep moving, men, to see what else you were called to do. The Lord God took the man and He put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. Okay, so you were called to work and to keep the land, which means you were called to provide and protect. Headship was given to you. Now, we have a lot of boys and grown boys around here walking, thinking that headship is something to take advantage of. That it's something to sit on a couch and bark orders at the people around you. That is not a man, that is a boy, that is a child. But a man who understands the weight of headship that was given to you, he understands that it is a calling to stand up and fight, to live and breathe protection and provision for the people around you. Now you need to realize that this was before Eve was formed. This is just Adam and God. And before the fall had even taken place, men, you were called to work. Which is kind of funny because sometimes work is of the devil. But you were called, before sin entered the world, you were called to work. Which really had me wondering something about our fishy friend crowd. I wonder if people were offended that Jesus was asking what they had. Because oftentimes we come to church and we want to consume and just come. Just keep coming and keep consuming. But we don't want to give anything. We don't want to have to cost us anything. We don't want to have to work for anything of God. We want it to be given to us. And I wonder if that crowd, if they had more to give. I know that they had more to give. Let's be real about that. I know that that fishy friend crowd, I know that they had more in their pockets. But I wonder if they refused to let go and they were selfish because of entitlement that they weren't supposed to have to work when Jesus was around. Men, it is your job to teach this generation what it means to work, and to sweat, and to sacrifice for your family and for your church. To put effort into heart into something. Our boys are watching you and they're learning what it looks like. If you are being lazy and cutting corners, if you're calling out of work in the morning because you stayed up all night playing video games, if you are at work, you're cutting corners on sheets and inventory because you don't feel like doing it, if you're hanging out with the dudes more than hanging out with your family because you need you time, if you're not making an effort to come and serve this church, but you put your butt in a seat every Sunday and you expect people to do something for you, our boys are watching you. We need you, men, to step into the calling that God placed upon your life. We need you to lead and to train up this generation. We need you to show them what it means to work. And yes, I 100% mean go to work, provide for your family. But what I really mean, men, is that we need you to work within this body. And remember, my heart is not to say things that you aren't doing, but to show you that when a man steps into the calling that God placed upon his life and sweats for the body of Christ, generations are moved. I wasn't able to be at the workday the other weekend. But you know what I heard? I heard that there are more men there than women, which is awesome. And while they were fixing things in the physical and they were getting this church ready for this weekend, they shifted something in the spirit. Those men walked into a holy calling that they are yet to understand. They unraveled something. And when men in our church start rising up and they start doing what God has called them to do, you can thank the men who gave up their Saturday and said, I'm going to be here and I'm going to serve. Men, the other thing that you are called by God to do is to protect. One of my favorite things about Adam in the garden is that Adam was made outside of the garden. And then God took Adam and he placed him inside of the garden and he said, work it. Protect it. But Eve, she was the crown of all creation, and she was made inside of that garden. She was made and designed there for Adam to protect. Now, I know the moment I said protect, half this room went into super ninja mode, and you started thinking about if a psycho killer were to come in here and take out all these people, what you would do to stand up and fight these people. I know that. I know that when you're bored of what I'm saying, you tune out and you start thinking about how you could be a hero and save the day, and how we would all think that you're awesome and we'd get this t-shirt with your face on it and you'd be our hero. And you men are flexing and you're nodding at me because you've got this protection thing down, right? And while I so appreciate that you are prepared if a psycho killer were to come in here, because I think that way through and through, Everyone is a killer. That's not the only way that you were designed to protect. See, there's a war around us that cannot be won in the flesh, but that is happening in the spirit. And men, a lot of you are at this war unprepared. If you want to line up your ninja stars and your boomerangs or whatever you use to fight people, but you come to this battle and your feet are grounded in anything other than the Word of God, you are standing by while the enemy takes captive everyone that you were called to protect. What good is a victory in the physical if they are spiritually dying? And maybe you would say, Heather, that makes no sense. How do I fight if I can't punch somebody in the face? Dude, you become a sponge. And you soak in every word of His truth. You stand at the doorway of your home and of your church. And you come, and you come prepared to be fed and to be poured into. Not coming here so you can sit down and look at stats and see when the Cowboys are going to play. Go Cowboys. You're welcome, AJ. There you go. Our fishy friend crowd, I know that more people had more food. But those that were before them failed to teach them how to soak in and be poured out. In this war, you have two choices, men. You can be a coward and you can stay seated in the crowd, or you can be the man of God that you were designed to be and stand up and start fighting and train the generation behind you in His word.
Amen.
You don't have to have all the answers. You don't even have to understand it all. But when you position yourself to be taught by God and position yourself to pray for your family, for this church, and for the generation behind you, you come to the war prepared. Because your God, He is feeding you and He is guiding you. Man, no one is expecting you to be perfect or have it all together. You're going to make mistakes. And we're going to give you grace because you need a helmet. But move forward in faith to provide and protect the generation behind you. Because revolution in faith, I'm proclaiming that our men are going to be faithful examples to follow. I'm believing in faith that a shifting is happening in this room where our men stand up and fight. I'm believing in faith. I'm believing in faith for them to take seriously the war that we are part of and to stop ignoring it. In faith, I'm believing this to be true. But our army is currently a little lopsided, so women, if it's okay, I'm going to switch to you. And all the men said, "Breathe, Jesus." There are some things that God has spoken over us from the very beginning of time that we need to remember as well. Let's read in Genesis 2, verse 18. I always feel awkward when people do this, so don't listen to me. Cool. Because I didn't spill it on myself. We're winning. Genesis 2, starting in verse 18. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the beasts of the field and all the birds of the air. And He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. Okay, which is like drives me nuts. I wasn't going to say this because I told myself not to be ADD. But like, how did Adam come up with like hippopotamus and rhino? I kind of understand what he was thinking. Okay, you don't care. Neither do I. Let's keep moving. He brought them to the man and to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called to each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave all the names to all the livestock, the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, He took out one of the man's ribs and closed it up with flesh. Then the Lord made the woman out of the rib that He was taking out of, and He brought her to the man. And the man said, "This is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." Back in the good old days in elementary school, I used to love birthdays, which I still do. I love my birthday, and I love birthdays then, but it didn't matter if it was my birthday then. It just needed to be somebody's birthday. And at my school, before everyone started going crazy and chewing on trees, we were able to bring cupcakes to school. And you were able to do that to celebrate with your class. Now, I hated those moms that like made cupcakes from scratch. Oh, they were disgusting. I hated them. I loved when my friends had those moms that were slacker moms that made it from like the Pillsbury Doughboy Funfetti box, Those are my favorite. And if that's you and you can make those cupcakes, make me a cupcake. I love snacks. Oh yeah, look at the snacks thing again. I love snacks, love cupcakes, so it's great. I love birthdays. But there was something even more cool that happened when it was somebody's birthday at my school. And you would always do this intentionally. You'd say, hey mom, I know that there's like 20 kids in my class, but could you like make 30 of them in case I want like 10 for myself? But you didn't tell her really why you wanted more cupcakes. Because there was this really cool thing that we did at our school with whatever leftover birthday cupcakes that you had from your class. You got to choose a friend, and you and your friend got to walk around the elementary school and like give it to your like your gym teacher and your art teacher and like your brother who was in fourth grade underneath you. And it was really, really cool. It was our favorite thing. And we had a term for our friend who helped you, and they were called the birthday helper. Nothing fancy, but no matter who you are, no matter if you hated the kids whose birthday it was, everybody wanted to be this birthday helper. It was the coolest thing ever. Which is funny to me because as I got older, helper was not so cool anymore. And I remember really studying this passage for the first time and thinking like, really, God? You designed me to be a helper. Couldn't you think of anything cooler? There ain't no way that you meant that for me. But I came into this passage full of ignorance and really missing the power behind this passage. Ladies, you were designed by God to be a helper. God could have chosen any body part to form you from, but he chose Adam's side. He could have chosen Adam's feet so that you would have been beneath him. He could have chosen Adam's head so that you would have been above him, but he didn't. He chose his side. God chose the side of Adam to form Eve, which means he intended for Eve to remain at the side of Adam. Man and women, they are created differently. They have different roles. They have different callings. But they were also created equally. Both men and women bear the image of the Almighty God. Adam was designed by God to lead Eve, but Eve was designed just as much in the image with purpose and a calling. Verse 18 says that the Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. Now, in our culture, the term helper has become something demeaning. And it has made this fun of that Eve is only good for a sandwich and cleaning the house. God created Eve to help Adam lead, whatever way possible, so that he could be the man of God that God had called him to be. He gave him a helper. Now, if that was cleaning the house or making dinner, eating chicken wings, I don't know, chicken wings, what do you call them? Wings. Ady told me that's how I help him, is that I eat chicken wings, which I don't totally love chicken wings, but they get stuck in my teeth. Doesn't matter. I help him. Great. Anyways, cool. But the Hebrew word for helper in this passage is Azer. Probably not saying that right. Don't be offended if you know how to say it. And this word is used by God as he helps the Israelites at war. He was their helper. He was their helpmate. He was their Azer. Eve was created to be a warrior in the kingdom of God. God never intended for Eve to be this delicate flower that sits behind Adam and waits to help. She was made to go to war side by side with Adam. So my question for you ladies today is, what are you doing with that warrior spirit inside of you? What are you doing with that warrior spirit that you were made with? Because let's be real, ladies, you're always fighting something. That warrior inside of you is hard to tame. And if you aren't grounded in the Word of God and under His submission, we will step out of the boundaries that were laid for us and we will start fighting battles that we were never made to fight. Are you fighting your husband? Are you fighting your children, your boss, your friends, this season that you're a part of? Now, I didn't say, are you fighting for them? I said, are you fighting them? Now, this would never happen with our women at Revolution, so just get that in your head from the very beginning then. But some women in this world think that their spiritual gift is nagging. And they think that is a calling upon them to nag to death everyone in their circle. Right? Not our church, right? The awkward laugh between the tension of men and females. These women see a problem in the world, and they see a problem with their friends at work and they just can't help themselves. They see a man that isn't living up to his potential, and that warrior spirit, because it is not refined, turns into nagging Nancy. Ladies, that is not how God intended you to go to war. And I promise you this, you will never win a battle with your husband, with your father, with your child, with your friend by nagging him. I promise you that. Ladies, have you ever wondered why you see things the way you do? The way your husband walks through the front door of this church a little uncomfortable? Nobody sees what you do. The way that your child seems to be smiling, but you see this ever breaking behind their eyes that nobody else sees but you do. The way your coworker avoids a certain conversation topic because some things are just too difficult to process right now. Nobody sees but you do. The way your friend shifts their body in worship because their season has left them feeling insecure and worn out. Nobody else sees but you do. You were given eyes into the war and a heart of a warrior to go into the spirit and fight on behalf of the things that people see every day and miss what you see straight into. The way to war on behalf of those around you is by hitting your knees and falling on your face before the Lord. Your enemy is manipulating you. He's making you think that you need to go to every single person and start gossiping and whining and complaining. What a spit, huh? He's got you so worked up that you dwell in every moment about what's going on, that you never hit your knees with your Father. And if I'm honest today, because I'm going to be honest with you, I don't care what your husband is or isn't doing. I don't care that your friends are terrible and that your season sucks. Because if you have not hit your knees and sought out the throne on their behalf, and I mean not just like, pray, dear God, fix this situation. I mean pray big, bold, earth-moving prayers. I do not care what you have to say. Because if you're going to stand back up and go continue on gossiping and whining about everything that is or isn't happening, but you refuse to hit your knees, I do not care. Because there is a generation of women behind you that are looking to you to show them how to hit their knees. They're depending on you to go to war to train them on how to go. I wonder where the warriors were on the day of the feeding of the 5,000. I wonder what battle was so important that they missed that miracle in front of them. One boy came forward, just one. In faith, I'm trusting and believing that Revolution, we're going to be women that recognize in faith our calling. We're going to be women that stand in the gates, before the gates of hell, and pray like crazy that our family, that our friends, that our husbands, that the people that we proclaim to love would not enter because we've laid out our bodies before them. That they would have to step over us to enter the gates of hell. Church, I'm not sure if you can tell or not, but there's a holy burden on me for the generation behind us. And I'm praying that you would leave here today with that same holy burden. Because church, if you don't realize this, if you stay seated, the kids behind you are going to stay seated. And I cannot have that because I don't have babies yet. But I'm counting on the generation behind me to leave my babies. I need you to move in this church. Because I need you to train up the kids behind you so that they'll train up my babies. So that I don't have to enter the gates of heaven and wonder where my children are. Yes, it is a holy burden for AJ and I to lead our family. But church, you are called, we call ourselves a tribe. We call ourselves a tribe because we can't do life alone. I cannot do this if you cannot do it. Church, the Lord showed me months ago before he told me that I was preaching on Sunday. He showed me this altar the Sunday after the girls' event. And he said they need to move. And I have decided because I'm not professional, I'm just going to gun it. If you would say you're in this place tonight, that you're tired of being a coward in the crowd and you're ready to stand and fight for the generation behind you, In just a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand up. When I ask you to stand, I don't want you to hesitate. If you're ready to stand before the generation behind you, I want you to move to this altar. I'm going to pray over you. And we're going to proclaim that something's going to shift in the spirit. That we're going to be the men and the women that God has called us to be. That he has ordained us to be from the very beginning of time, before you were even together in your mother's womb. So church, if you're ready to be the man or the woman of God that you were called to be, would you move and come to this altar?
God, I pray continually that we would be undone in front of your presence, God.